raise the dead. Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the keys that set us free? He paid it all to bring us peace. Jesus, only Jesus.
Scripture reading this evening before Doug's lesson is Psalm 5, verses 7 and 8. But I, through the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter your house. I will bow down toward your holy temple in the fear of you. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me.
Let's bow. Father, we're so very blessed to be able to come back here in this first day of the week, in the evening, to spend time with our brothers and sisters, to hear a portion of your word, to spend that time diving deep into it, to understand better the things that you have left for us, that we might apply them, that we might live them out, that we might extend them to others, to teach them, to help them. As we look at the subject of righteousness, Lord, tonight, I pray that we might understand that we can never be righteous in our own right, that you are the one who has all righteousness, that we can only come into yours, and so we need to be led in your righteousness, Lord. Let us be counted among them rather than with the wicked that you take no delight in. And we thank you, Lord, for recording the things here in your word that we might explore them and understand them better for our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so as we've been working through the book of Psalms on Sunday nights, we are only in Psalm number 5. And so there are 150 Psalms, and they're broken up into five different books, and we can see the numbers of chapters within each one of those divisions that have been made there. And so we are in book one right now, in Psalm number 5, and we see that it is listed as a lament. A lament meaning a cry to God for help. And we've seen one of these before. In fact, Psalm 4 was one of these as well, where the writer of the psalm, David in this case, and I believe last time as well, is crying out to God for help and intercession, intervention in his life. And so sure enough, we see that it is listed as a psalm of David, and even though those titles are probably not part of Scripture, they're very ancient, most scholars believe, and so for the purposes that we have here, we're going to assume that David is the writer of that, and that he is the one crying out with the lament. And so as we take a look at the psalm, we make a distinction, a division within the psalm, and there are five very distinct sections in the 12 verses of this psalm that we see here. The very first division that we see are verses 1 through 3, and here it is that David is in distress. And he's crying out to God. He calls God his king. He is asking God for help and intervention in his life. It says, "Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my groaning. Give attention to the sound of my cry, my king and my God. For to you do I pray. O Lord, in the morning you hear my voice. In the morning I prepare a sacrifice for you and watch." Maybe you've been there before. I know Psalms have often been a very favorite of many people. They've given a lot of meaning to life, and sometimes when we're going through a rough time, there are Psalms that really speak to what it is that we are feeling in this human condition that we are created in. And maybe we've identified here with David in the distress that he's feeling. But one thing we might note as the psalm opens is that David is very confident that God hears him. He prepares a sacrifice. That's what he can do. David can't control the outcome. He can't control how it is that God will hear. He has to trust only in God's goodness, that God will hear his prayer, that God does care about his distress that he is in. And so he prepares a sacrifice. What sacrifice do we prepare as Christians? Right? We are to offer our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is our spiritual act of sacrifice, we are told. And so as we live for God, as we offer ourselves upon the altar as a living sacrifice to God, to do with us as we would he would like us to do, then all we can do is sit back and watch, as David says here in verse 3. When he sits back and watches, he is trusting in God for an answer. He knows that God hears, he's confident about that, but he knows also that he cannot do anything with the outcome, that he must trust God for the answer and that God will answer. Maybe you've heard the story before of the drought that was happening. Perhaps this was out in Texas or Oklahoma or someplace like that. And a bunch of farmers got together to pray for rain, and yet there was only one little boy who showed up with an umbrella. And as I say that, I can hear the rain and the thunder on the roof here, right? If you pray for rain, you need to carry an umbrella because God does answer prayers. And so tonight we're going to look at, if you need help, then you need to be righteous. You need to be led in God's righteousness in order to expect God to answer your prayers. For you are not a God who delights in wickedness. The second section of this psalm is again 3 verses long, and so will bring us to the halfway point of the psalm itself, being just 12 verses. But we get into God's character here about the kinds of things that God will listen to and that he delights in, that he's pleased with. Verses 4 through 6 says, "For you are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil may not dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all evildoers. You destroy those who speak lies. The Lord abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man." And so if we expect God to answer our prayers, then we need to be in fellowship with God. We can see that God does not change. We can't expect him to change to be like us. And so we need to change to be like God. If we want fellowship with God, we need to become like God. In the New Testament, we hear about God's character as well. In 1 John chapter 1, it says, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all." If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie. We lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us of all sin. And so our character needs to be the character of God. God is light, in him is no darkness. And so in us, we must be about light. And in us, there should be no darkness. And if we do struggle and sin, then we can confess our sins and we walk in the light, continue to walk in the light in that case. And the blood of Jesus, his son, continues to purify us from all sin. That word there, kaphale, is a continual cleansing that goes on. It's a continuous verb there that's being used. And so he cleanses us from our sins if we walk in the light as he is in the light. That's a big if. And so we need to continue to show the character of God and confess when we fall short of that, and God will forgive us of that sins. But that's not what we tend to do with that. When we fall short, sometimes we push it aside and try to lie about it, try to hide it. It's been the same way since the Garden of Eden, hasn't it? But as we see 1 John chapter 1 continuing, it says, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." And so we find out some things about God's character also in this passage, as we hear that he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I think most parents know when a kid has done wrong, or you come home and you see that your dog has tore apart the couch or something, and you're like, who did that? Is it because you don't know who did that? Hopefully we're talking about the dog and not the kid in this instance. Who did that? You know who did that. God knows the sin that we do. If we say we've not sinned, we make him a liar. We're saying, oh, God, you're wrong. You don't know anything about me, and God knows everything about us. His word is not in us, it says. We can't live by our own standards like the wicked do. We just saw that God does not delight in wickedness, but we can't say also that we are on his side and continue to live like the world lives and compromise like the world compromises. If we do that, then we lie. There are six things that we are told the Lord hates in Proverbs chapter 6. And if we count them, I believe that there are seven. There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and one who sows discord among brothers. God is not a God that delights in wickedness. But what are we to do? Because we don't have any righteousness of our own, it's not like we can just decide to do better from this point on and God will suddenly delight in us because we are suddenly righteous in our own eyes. We have to confess our wickedness, and he is faithful and just to forgive us. So how is it that we can become righteous? We have to be led in God's righteousness. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. And so David starts out this third section of Psalm 5 with the word but. The word but always is a change in direction here from the way that he was going. We've just described the wicked and how God does not take delight in them. We've seen some of the things that they might do. And now David is making a plea in his groaning to God, saying, I understand what the wicked do, and I'm trying not to be like them. I need help. Because of his own nature, David realizes his own character is such that he is very similar to those wicked. He can see how it is. He falls short continually. And so he starts out, verse 7, but I, through the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter your house. I will bow down toward your holy temple in the fear of you. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me. Through the abundance, the grace that God has of your steadfast love. It's not David's ability that he is leaning on. He is trusting in God's abundance of steadfast love to be able to get him through. He's looking to be led in God's righteousness because God needs to show him the way that he must go and make him righteous. If we fast forward in history to the time of the captivity in Judah, where we see that Jerusalem is destroyed and the last inhabitants are being carried off into captivity, Jeremiah writes the book of Lamentations. And in Lamentations chapter 3, we can also see a very similar theme happening here. He says, but this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Isn't that how we just started the psalm out? David offered the sacrifice, and then he said, I will wait for the Lord. And so David, recognizing that nothing good lives within him, that he needs God's righteousness, but he needs to be led in God's righteousness so that he knows what direction to go, he trusts fully in the hope that God's steadfast love that never ceases will come to him in God's faithfulness. David makes God his portion. God is everything that he wants from this life and the next. That's not the way the people of the world live, though, is it? People of the world live by making idols. Those idols may not be carved out of stone and wood and such today, but they're carved out of things that satisfy self and put a stumbling block between us and God. And that's what we tend to do. And we're told here in Habakkuk chapter 2 that we're not to make those idols. What profit is an idol when its maker has shaped it, a metal image, a teacher of lies? For its maker trusts in his own creation when he makes speechless idols. Woe to him who says to a wooden thing, awake, to a silent stone, arise. Can this teach? Behold, it is overlaid with gold and silver, and there is no breath at all in it. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Notice the contrast here between the things that the wicked pursue that God takes no delight in versus David recognizing that the Lord must be his portion, and the word but appears in verse 20 as well. Another change of direction. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Where the idols have no power and no way to satisfy, God is fully able to satisfy, and he is in control and can give us his righteousness. And our response is to be silent before him. In those verses 7 and 8 that we just read of Psalm 5, we could see that David is bowing before God's holy temple, and he's recognizing that that's where he needs to be for God to be his portion. David has no righteousness. He needs God's righteousness. And yet, what is his condition? What's his struggle that's going on? It's the same struggle that goes on within us. In Romans chapter 7, we always used to call this the doo-doo passage back in Plattsburgh because there's a lot of the word do over and over again here. For I do not understand my own actions. For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. And so you see the struggle that David is in here in Psalm 5. He wants God to come and help him in his distress. He knows God doesn't delight in wickedness, and yet when David examines his own life, that's what he sees going on in himself. And he's asking God to lead him in his righteousness so that he could be counted differently than the rest of the world that will be destroyed, but also seek to destroy David. Make them bear their guilt, O God, for they have rebelled against you. The enemies seek to destroy David, and we see here in this fourth section, verses 9 and 10 of the psalm, for there is no truth in their mouth. Their inmost self is destruction. Their throat is an open grave. They flatter with their tongue. Make them bear their guilt, O God. Let them fall by their own counsels. Because of the abundance of their transgressions, cast them out. For they have rebelled against you. Here we look at the enemy's character, the enemies that are against David. where David is trying to make a separation from his enemies. What's the difference? They're not looking to repent. They're not looking to live for God. David is struggling and trying to be led by God and his righteousness to be counted among the righteous so that he can. And we see the truth of the matter in the New Testament, Romans chapter 3. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. There's another reference to Psalm 5. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their path are ruin and misery. In the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now to the world, I'm sure that they seem righteous to themselves, but in reality, there's no fear of God before their eyes. The Christian would be wise to recognize that we can't be like the world and follow into the same trap of lies that the world tells themselves, that they're fine the way they are. They don't need to change. Everybody, including God, if there is a God, ought to accept them the way they are. Instead, we need to be like David, who recognizes his sin, recognizes the struggles that he has in being righteous and following God's righteousness, and trust God for that. If we contrast the righteousness of God here, we can see that righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Steadfast love, there's that phrase again, and faithfulness go before you. Psalm 89 and verse 14. And so, if we have no guidance, if we continue to live like the world lives, where there's no guidance, Proverbs 11 says, a people falls, but in an abundance of counselors there is safety. And so we must be like God. How is it that our guilt can be borne? What can we do here whatsoever with our sin that we have? And we see the character that we need to have is to be like God in every way, who is righteous, righteousness and justice being the foundation of his throne, steadfast love and faithfulness going before him. We need to be like that. In Ephesians 5 and verse 3 says, there must not even be a named among you a hint of sin as is proper among saints. And so we see that David cries out for them to bear their guilt. He's calling for his enemies' guilt to be borne by them. The wicked, you don't delight in God. Let them bear their own guilt. They have rebelled against you. And we can see here that as Samuel is talking to Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 15, he speaks about this kind of rebellion against God that Saul has just committed there. And it says, "Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as the sin of divination, and presumption is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king." We can't fall into that trap to think that, you know, our righteousness is showing up church at every time that the door is open. To think that if we, you know, contribute a dish to a meal, if we've encouraged a neighbor, if we've done these things, that somehow we've checked the boxes and now we have God's righteousness. Instead, the Lord does not delight in wickedness, but he does delight in the obedience to his voice, we can see here. And so there's the key to all of this and how it is that David can find help. He must submit himself to God, be led by God's righteousness, obey God in the way that God asks him to do, and then we can come into his righteousness. And so David begins with a cry for help, and he ends with his own character. The last couple of verses, "But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy and spread your protection over them, that those who love your name may exult in you. For you bless the righteous, O Lord. You cover him with favor as with a shield." That'd be the kind of thing we want to hear if we were in the distress as David. But we must come into the refuge of the Lord, and then we can rejoice. We need to sing for joy because of God's faithfulness and His steadfast love, knowing that we come under His shield, His protection. If you love His name, you'll exalt Him, you'll bless Him with righteousness, and you'll be on God's side. If you've not obeyed the gospel, this is an opportunity to do so. If you have done so, but you've not been living it out, this is also an opportunity to come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation.
Holy King of Love.